On Monday evening, August 14th, 2000, at 5:20 p.m., I left Amityville, heading to India. This would be the fourth time I have traveled to India, and though it always is a thrill, it also requires a bit of preparation and long travel time. To prepare for the journey, I had obtained a three-month tourist visa, taken malaria medicine for a week, and suffered a gamma globulin shot. I also packed a supply of Imodium and a mosquito netting for my bed. My initial destination was to be the ashram of Sri Sathya Sai Baba, which is not known for its luxury. The flight to Mumbai, which used to be called Bombay, is a long one. The first leg went from JFK to Frankfurt, Germany. We left JFK at 8:05 p.m. on Monday night and landed in Frankfurt at 8:30 a.m. Tuesday morning. At noon Frankfurt time, we departed for Mumbai. We flew out of Frankfurt, heading for Bombay. The flight to Bombay was another 9 hours long and landed in Bombay at midnight, Wednesday morning, Bombay time, or 1:30 p.m. on Tuesday afternoon in Amityville. After gathering my luggage and changing my dollars into rupees, I took a taxi to the Kapinski Leela Hotel, a five-star hotel close to the airport. I was given a beautiful room and fell asleep in air-conditioned comfort. In the morning, I had a sumptuous breakfast and toured the lobby area. One of the misconceptions about India is that all Indians are poor. That is not the case. India has a population of 930 million people. Of that, about 280 million, the equivalent to the population of the United States, live middle-class lives with TVs, cars, nice clothes, and jobs. There also is a wealthy class, one that you see in places like the Kapinski Leela. The shops in the lobby made this abundantly clear. It would have been nice to stay longer, but I had to check out and take a taxi to Veracruz National Airport for a flight to Puttaparthi, the village of Sathya Sai Baba's ashram. The traffic going to Mumbai International Airport was stopped. Fortunately, we were heading in the opposite direction. It was nice to see all the people going to work. We also passed a large homeless village. Mumbai is a place to find jobs, so millions of people come looking for jobs. But even after finding a job, finding living quarters is even harder. The flight to Puttaparthi leaves only on Wednesdays and Sundays. The flight leaves in the morning and returns to Mumbai that afternoon. It wasn't always that easy. When I went to Puttaparthi in 1984, you had to fly to Bangalore and take a 4-hour cab ride to Puttaparthi. The flight to Puttaparthi was about half full, mostly Westerners, and I started thinking about the first time I visited India, and I visited Puttaparthi a year later. In 1981, my daughter Susan, not yet 16, was chosen by the Amityville Rotary Club to be an exchange student during her junior year in high school. Her destination was India. There she lived with the Jagada family of Bombay. Anjali Jagada, also Susan's age, came to the United States through the Rotary and lived in Smithtown, Long Island for her junior year. In January 1982, I visited Susan in India, and we took a tour through northern India. We stayed at the Rambar Palace, a Maharaja's palace, now a hotel. We stayed in the presidential suite, the same suite Bill Clinton stayed in when he visited in 2000. We rode an elephant to the Pink Palace. Susan rode a camel. We saw wild monkeys in the streets of Jaipur, snake charmers, and the Taj Mahal. I had only heard of Sai Baba a week before I went to India and was surprised while standing in front of Susan's apartment building, a holy man walked up to me and said, "Sai Baba sends his blessings," and touched my forehead with a tikka. In 1983, the Jagada family moved from Bombay to Bangalore. Anjali's father invited me to visit them in their new home, and I did. One of the attractions was that Bangalore is only about 80 miles from Puttaparthi and Sai Baba's ashram. I arrived on Friday evening and was informed by Didaj that he and his wife Gisela would drive me to the ashram on Saturday morning and stay for the weekend with me. The land surrounding Puttaparthi is barren and inhospitable. When we arrived at the ashram, I was given a room which I shared with another American. Didaj and Gisela were given their own private quarters. The ashram was quiet with about 1,000 or so devotees staying there. I was given a room in the round building, a newly built building reserved for Westerners. The room was not furnished. My cost was 50 cents a day. Early each morning, people would line up for what is called darshan, or vision of the divine. Men and women would sit quietly while Sai Baba appeared and walked among them. He would accept letters, manifest ash, which is called vibhuti, and sometimes invite people for a private audience called an interview. At this time, the mandir, or temple building, provided a room where Sai Baba lived, and the darshan would take place in the sandy area in front of the building. The Puna Chandra is another large building at the ashram. It is a large hall with a stage. During the day, lectures concerning spiritual growth are given here. During the evening, bhajan sings and plays are also presented. During the day, there would be lectures, and we would go out into the village also. The village was small and consisted of a few stores selling foods and goods. One day, my roommate and I hired a rickshaw and toured the area. The buildings surrounding the ashram were very pretty. They were schools built by the Sai organization, free schools. Today, the organization has about 100 such schools scattered around India. The ashram had its own dairy. In the early evening, Sai Baba would again appear, and everyone would gather to sing bhajans. Devotional songs praising holy people. I heard many stories about miracles that Sai Baba performed, such as healings, materializations, and vibhuti growing on photos of Sai Baba. I had personally witnessed the materialization of vibhuti on the darshan line. You could feel the love emanating from this man, and the love in return from his devotees. I returned to Bangalore convinced that this man was special.
Ladies and gentlemen, welcome to Puttaparthi. The temperature outside is 30 degrees Celsius. Kindly remain seated and refrain from opening overhead lockers till the aircraft comes to a complete halt and the seatbelt sign is switched off.
After an 18-year wait and 2 days of traveling, I finally reached Puttaparthi. Small buses were waiting for the flight, and soon we were heading to Prasanthi Nilayam, Sai Baba's ashram. The amount of new buildings was surprising. Mostly condos and hostels for people visiting the ashram. The village of Puttaparthi now was a long main street, complete with traffic and crowds. Soon we entered the ashram gates and were deposited at registration. I was given a room on the fourth floor of a new set of apartments that had been built. Now I'll grant you, it wasn't the Kempinski Leela. However, it was only $1 a day, and it was a far improvement from the first time I stayed at the ashram. Especially the ceiling fan and also the shower. I would share it with Ralph. Ralph was from Munich, Germany. He was with a large group that had come to stage a play for Sai Baba. The area outside my apartment was like a college campus with a very peaceful and quiet environment. There were now 5 round buildings and many more apartment buildings surrounding them. The ashram could hold between 10 and 20,000 people at this time. Main Street contained bookstores, canteens, and other services related to the ashram. Photography of the darshan area was now limited to those who received prior permission from Sai Baba. I was not one.
Hi,
After settling down in my room, I went to find my good friend, Dr. Girish Dixit, and his singing group, Sai Lahari. One reason I came to Puttaparthi this week was because Girish had asked me to come to oversee the audio and video recording of his group when they performed for Sai Baba. Sai Lahari is a singing group based in New Jersey, specialized in singing Sai Baba bhajans of different countries. When I found Girish, his group was practicing a song called Aligato Sai Baba, a Japanese song thanking Sai Baba. Sai Lahari consisted of about 35 people. They had come to India to perform for Sai Baba, but to date there was no guarantee when and if that would happen. Ashram life had changed over the years. Now there were 10 to 20,000 people each morning at darshan. Each morning, when darshan was over, I would walk outside the ashram to the local communications center. It was a small shop with three computers and a telephone capable of calling long distance. There I would call home and chat with my wife for a few minutes. After the call, I would walk down to my favorite restaurant and bookstore, Sai Tower. There I would eat my breakfast and read The Hindu, an English language newspaper published in Bangalore. On Sunday, the paper had an Indian-style personal column, one where individuals and families advertised for husbands and wives. It's very interesting what counts. Education, appearance, caste, job, and horoscope, all were important. Sai Tower also sold books and tourist items. The number of books written about Sai Baba was very large. It was hot and humid day and night at the ashram, and Sai Tower's air-conditioned comfort was why I chose to eat my breakfast and dinner there each day. I generally skip lunch. After breakfast, I would return to my room, shower for the second time, change my clothes, and take my wash down to the Dobiwalas. The Dobiwalas take your laundry and wash it by smashing it against stones on a riverbed. Each day I would give my laundry to the Dobiwala and receive yesterday's laundry in return, cleaned and folded neatly. This would cost about 40 cents. The days at the ashram went by quickly. On Monday, I decided to take a tour of the countryside, as I did on my last visit. Only this time, instead of a bicycle rickshaw, I hired a motorized one. It took a long time to get out of town and pass the traffic. The college and school buildings still looked the same, but there was also a new planetarium built and a new music hall in construction. On the road again, we passed the airport and came to the Sai Baba Super Specialty Hospital. I had been told by American doctors who volunteered at the hospital that it was as modern and well-equipped as any in the U.S. The hospital does not charge for any of its services, which include major surgeries. Back on the road, we saw another Psy building in construction. A group of ladies in a rice field also noticed the camera. They posed and held a pose as long as the camera was on them. Saris are truly elegant-looking fashions. We next stopped to look at a lake and discovered a wedding party taking place at the restaurant. The young bride was sitting with her friends. Kids love to smile for the camera. As poor as they are, they certainly are always smiling. Recognizing me as an American, obvious from the ashram, they would chant Sai Baba to me, hoping that I would give them some money. Soon, we were out in the fields, where the only sound you would hear is the bullock cart's cowbell. But not for long. On Monday night, my roommate Ralph and his group had their performance at the Puna Chandra. Ralph was in the choir. As usual, Sai Baba made his appearance just before showtime. As he sat down, the crowd realized the show was about to start. I didn't realize the effort that his group had made. The scenery, costumes, and music were all developed for the play. They brought it all from Germany for the opportunity to perform for Sai Baba. The play told the story of Elizabeth, a young woman of royal descent, married to the prince. She spends all her time and money feeding and helping the poor.
I am so grateful to my beloved Lord Jesus Christ that he has made it possible for us to provide food to all the starving ones. Ludwig will be very glad too.
Her husband is killed in the Crusades, and she ends up penniless herself. On her deathbed, a child whose life she saved tends her. Elizabeth of Thuringen died at the age of 24. She is considered a saint by Christians all over Germany. Here she was escorted to heaven by Jesus Christ. Sai Baba, who attends all the performances, came on stage and materialized a necklace for the woman who is Saint Elizabeth. On Wednesday, August 23rd, I slept in. It would be my last day at the ashram, and I decided to make it a leisurely one. I walked slowly into the village and took in the sights. Unfortunately, it was a rainy day. I called home, ate breakfast as usual, then I arranged for a taxi to pick me up at the ashram at 1:30. My flight was scheduled to leave Puttaparthi at 2 p.m. I returned to the ashram and checked in with Girish. He had good news and bad news. The good news was that Sai Lahari would get to perform in front of Sai Baba at the Poonachandra. The bad news was that it would be on Friday night. This meant that many people would have to reschedule their flights, causing some very high increases in their tickets. I said goodbye and wished them well with the concert. Soon the taxi came and took me to the airport.
Okay, let's go. Smile. Here we go.
All right, thank you.
Sai Ram. Can you wash the window?
As we headed down Main thank Street you. To the Ganesha Gate, I felt a bit sad. For a week, I had lived a Spartan existence, eating vegetarian food, no alcohol, going to bed at 9:30 each night, no television, no radio, just my morning Hindu times. Now, I would be going to Mumbai to visit Anjali and Vikram, an entirely different world. I arrived at the airport only to find that my flight had been canceled due to the heavy rains. I immediately took a taxi to Bangalore. The driver had an interesting grouping on the dashboard. A Ganesha, a Sai Baba, and a Donald Duck. If you ever go to India, don't even think of driving yourself. The rules of the road are very different. You drive on the left side of the road. A horn is indispensable. The cars have little power for passing, and animals and rickshaws are cutting in and out. The driver said he could make the trip in 3 hours, getting me there for the 5 p.m. flight to Mumbai. To add to this, my taxi's only windshield wiper stopped working. We arrived at Bangalore Airport at about 5:30. The flight had gone. The next flight left at 11 p.m. I arrived in Mumbai at midnight. Anjali sent a driver to fetch me and take me to their apartment. When I woke up Thursday morning, I thought I was in a dream. There was a beautiful room with a Sai Baba altar at the end. At the other end was a table prepared for breakfast. A maid came with fresh scrambled eggs. Music was playing, and a beautiful woman was walking towards me. It was Anjali. This was her new apartment in Mumbai. She and her husband Vikram purchased it a few months before and had just finished redecorating it. There had been a bhajan sing at the house on Tuesday, and that explained the altar. Anjali's mother Gisla, who now lives in the village of Pune, came down to Mumbai especially to see me. It was great to see Anjali and Gisla. Vikram had gone to work, so Anjali and Gisla looked after me. Anjali called for her car and driver, and we were off into the streets of Mumbai. The monsoon had come to Mumbai. As we drove through the streets, I couldn't help but think how much has passed since 1981. Anjali graduated from Randolph Macon University in Virginia. Vikram, her boyfriend, graduated from Duke University. In the mid-80s, Anjali's father, Diraj, died of a stroke. Gisla and Jasmine, Anjali's sister, moved back to Mumbai. Anjali and Vikram were married in California and lived in San Francisco for a number of years. Vikram worked in Silicon Valley. They had two children, Raul and Tyra. When Vikram's father got sick, Vikram and Anjali came back to Mumbai, where he and his two brothers now run the family business. Anjali loves shopping, and she knows where to shop in Mumbai. Our first stop was the Oberoi Hotel, where we bought three pashminas from Kashmir for my wife and children. I had brought a list of items to bring home to my wife and daughters, and Anjali patiently selected the various pieces of jewelry described on the list. Next came lunch. It was in a beautiful cafe in downtown Mumbai. Late in the afternoon, we drove to a small apartment in Mumbai. The owner, a Sai Baba devotee, had a room devoted to provide darshan to all who came. The front of the room was covered with photographs and statues of Sai Baba and other religious figures. Many of the photographs had vibhuti growing on them. Some of it would form the Om sign or a cross. One area where the vibhuti was wiped away regularly and collected at the bottom provided a source of the vibhuti for visitors. This materialization of vibhuti on photographs occurs at the homes of many devotees. One member of the Sai Lahari singing group has this happen in her house in New Jersey. It's time to party. A glass of wine at the apartment, and then into Mumbai for a night on the town. Our first stop was the Oberoi Hotel. There are two main hotels in Mumbai, the Oberoi and the Taj Mahal. The Oberoi had just added a new section, and we started the evening in their cafe. Isla, Anjali, and Vikram sat next to me. Vikram's brother Suvia and their longtime friend Nikki had joined us. I felt like an insider, seeing the young generation that will be taking over India in the next decade. These were not poor people. They were the legacy children of successful businessmen and women in India. They all spoke excellent English, were college educated, many in the US, and were now running large companies in India. Nikki's company provided textiles to the likes of L.L. Bean and J.C. Penney. Nikki was the middleman, guaranteeing the quality and price of shirts and other clothing sewn in factories in southern India. Vikram Malani and his brothers Suvia and Sanjeev were running Vulcan Furnace, a company Vikram's grandfather started after he came to Bombay penniless due to the partition in 1948. Vikram has added his computer expertise, starting a new division of the company, developing software for the internet. The singer was Dana Gillespie, a popular blues and jazz singer from Great Britain. The house piano player was surprisingly good playing blues. Dana later visited our table. She told me she was a Sai Baba devotee also and had recorded many bhajan CDs. She gave me her latest one titled Songs of Love to be released to celebrate Sai Baba's 75th birthday on November 23rd, 2000. Ms. Gillespie said she would be there for the event singing for Sai Baba. Our final stop was for dinner. People eat late in Mumbai, and I mean late. It was after 11 p.m. before we sat down in the crowded restaurant. The menu, in English, featuring Western cooking, showed that global taste had crept into Mumbai's restaurant scene. Had a lovely meal and returned to the apartment quite tired. It was Friday. My last day in India. Anjali and Gisela took me shopping again, as my list still had a few items, such as a necklace for my wife and toe rings for my daughter Susan. Anjali and Gisela are two very active women. Gisela, who is a talented dress designer, runs a small shop in Pune, where she and her daughter Jasmine design and manufacture nightgowns. Anjali has two boutiques in Mumbai, where she sells the clothing manufactured by Gisela. We passed one of the stores called Papillon. Our next stop was the Mahatma Gandhi Museum. This was the house Gandhi lived in. His library. Bed, spinning wheels, and writing desk were on display. Also, there was a wonderful telling of his life through handmade depictions of major events. We next went to the Breach Candy Beach Club for lunch. It is a private club situated on the Indian Ocean with two swimming pools and a lovely restaurant. It's sort of Bombay's Unkwa. My daughter Susan spent a great deal of time here when she was in India. We returned to the apartment, and I packed for my flight that evening. Gisela left to return to Pune. I dined with Anjali, Vikram, and their family at still another fine restaurant. As we were dining, Sai Lahari was performing at the Punachandra. Sai Baba gave the women saris and the men dhotis. As I flew back towards Frankfurt, I couldn't believe that the 10 days had passed so quickly. Visions of so many different images passed by me. It was a wonderful trip. The Milani family were great hosts, and I look forward to seeing them again, either in New York or Mumbai.
Promise that I'll run away with you. I'll run away.